Good evening. My name is Jean Quam. I'm the interim dean in the College of Education and Human Development, which is the home, the proud home, to the School of Kinesiology and the Tucker Center. I want to tell you a little bit about the Tucker Center. It was established in 1993 with a generous gift from Dr. Dorothy Tucker. Dr. Tucker is a 1945 graduate of the U of M in the School of Kinesiology. The Tucker Center remains the only university-based interdisciplinary center in the country devoted to research, education, and outreach for girls and women involved in sport and physical activity. Over the last three decades, women's participation in sport and physical activity has been unprecedented. But the scientific study of this landmark development was lagging far behind. What was needed was a place in higher education that would provide leadership and promote the scientific, interdisciplinary study of women's sports from exercise science to social and psychological development. The Tucker Center is that place. The center seeks to not only advance knowledge, but to attract the best and brightest to come to the University of Minnesota and share pathbreaking knowledge and experience on issues of significance to all those who care about women's full engagement in sport and physical activity. As we all know from a historical perspective, females' participation was either denied altogether, or those who did participate were often stigmatized. But in the wake of Title IX, many barriers have been eliminated, and many females are now given the same opportunities as our males. Nowhere is this change more apparent or important than when we witness the amazing accomplishments on a global stage of female Olympians. I am very excited, as I'm sure you are, to hear the stories and feel the pride of the Minnesota sportswomen who represented our university, state, and country in the Olympics. At the risk of sounding a little political, I'm a hockey mom. And to not steer you too far wrong, I do wear a button that says Hockey Mama for Obama. But I am the mother of two teenage athletes who watch the Olympics with me on TV every night, and we were spellbound by both the male and the female athletes. And I think many of you probably shared that experience, that it was just a remarkable experience to have, and particularly a remarkable experience to share with your children. It is also my pleasure to introduce Mary Jo Kane. The Tucker Center would not exist today without the vision and leadership provided by Professor Kane. She continues to serve the center's first and only director and is also, in her spare time, the department chair in the School of Kinesiology. Professor Kane received her PhD from the University of Illinois in 1985 with an emphasis in sports sociology. She's an internationally recognized scholar who has published extensively on the media stereotypic treatment of athletic females. She is also known as an expert on the passage and impact of Title IX. In 1996, Professor Kane was awarded the first distinguished professorship related to women in sport, the Dorothy McNeil Tucker Chair for Women in Sport and Exercise Science. Professor Kane was recently elected by her peers as a fellow in the American Academy of Kinesiology, the highest honor in her field. In 2004, Professor Kane received the Scholar of the Year Award from the Women's Sports Foundation. This award is given to researchers who make significant research contributions in the area of women's sports. From my perspective as her dean, Mary Jo Kane is our very own MVP, our ace, our all-star, I was trying to think of other words here, our franchise player, and a scholar and leader in the field of Olympian proportions. So please welcome Mary Jo Kane.
Thank you, Dean Quam. I don't know if you know this, but we tape all of our events, and so those last remarks, when I go up for a merit review this year, I'll save the tape. Before I begin my introduction of the person I'm going to be introducing as our distinguished moderator. I want to thank you all for coming to tonight's presentation. I also want to let you know that there'll be a reception right after the presenter's remarks and what I'm sure will be a thought-provoking question and answer session. And during the reception, our panelists will be signing autographs. Finally, I want to acknowledge members of the Tucker team for all the hard work that they have done behind the scenes. Aaron Becker, Austin Calhoun, Chelsea Thule, and Jonathan Sweet. And I want to give a special thanks to Associate Director Dr. Nicole Lavoie, who has overseen this entire event, which is no small task. So how about a round of applause for the Tucker team? It goes without saying that the Olympics captivate our imaginations, fill us with pride as we witness the amazing accomplishments of athletes from around the globe, and inspire us all. To set the tone for this evening's event, we want to share with you a very short video called Let It Out from, believe it or not, Kleenex. Clearly, the Olympics are a tradition-filled world stage event for all the peoples of the world to celebrate. One purpose of our lecture tonight is to do precisely that, honor and celebrate some of Minnesota's finest Olympians. But a second and equally important purpose is to place the Olympics in an historical context, because in the final analysis, they are always about more than wins and losses and medal counts. They take place within broader social and political factors, and the lived experiences of the sportswomen we will hear from tonight are often influenced by these events. To help us frame the importance and the complexity of the Olympics is one of the University of Minnesota's very own, Professor Doug Hartmann. Professor Hartmann is Associate Chair in the Department of Sociology. He also serves as President of Sociologists of Minnesota. He received his MA in the Social Sciences from the University of Chicago and his PhD from the University of California, San Diego. The author of numerous publications and a book on the 1968 Olympics, Professor Hartmann's research examines race and ethnicity, sports, popular culture, and contemporary theory. He is particularly well-suited to serve as the moderator for tonight's event. Last May, he taught Beijing Olympics, Sports and Globalization. As part of the class assignment, he and his students traveled to Beijing to gain some firsthand knowledge of history in the making, and that is a very impressive class assignment, Professor Hartmann. I was thinking about that when I was going over my introduction, and I thought, my class assignments usually involve traveling to, St. Paul, Starbucks, the West Bank. We haven't hit Beijing yet. Who paid for that? Did the sociology department pay for that? Don't ask. In 2006, Professor Hartmann received the Distinguished Contribution to Scholarship Award from the American Sociological Association, and in 2008, he was named an Early Distinguished Scholar by the Midwest Sociological Society. As moderator, Professor Hartmann will make some opening remarks to frame this evening's discussion, then introduce our panelists and lead us through what I know will be an interesting and inspirational journey for all of us. Please join me in welcoming Professor Doug Hartmann.
Thanks, Mary Jo, and Nicole for setting this up, and all of you for coming. This isn't about me. I'm really excited to be here. It's about the Olympians we have in our midst. I was sitting over here and kind of wanting to be over there and eavesdrop on their conversation. So we'll have it up here in just a few minutes. I'm a little nervous. If you've been watching the various presidential debates, the moderators haven't done well. If you read Neil Justin's Star Tribune column, he said, it's not clear who won the debates, but it's clear who lost. And it was the moderators. So, you know, be easy on me. Let me do my job. I'm just trying to make you look good. What I want to do is just a few minutes, say a few words about the Olympics to kind of set a context for this august panel and event. And I hope it won't go way overboard, but I do want to say a little bit about the Olympics in Beijing. That's what I've been researching with these trips that I've taken recently, what I've been thinking about. And I guess the starting point for me, both for the Olympics, for the trips, and for all the work I do around sports is I'm really interested in sports. I'm a fan, I'm a spectator, but the real reason why I study this is about the social significance of that surrounds the sports world, how practices of sport relate to broader social forces, and what they can tell us about politics, nationalism, race, ethnicity, sexuality, international relations, and of course, gender. For me, the Olympics and sports in general are always a stage, an opportunity to see in play social dynamics that I'm constantly trying to get my students to think about more seriously. And sport is a way that if we read it rightly, we can learn a lot more than just who's winning and losing on the field. The Olympics are a particularly charged and important form for the study of sport because of the obvious international context and global reach. There is no other sporting event that parallels the Olympics in the world. The World Cup probably comes closest, but the simultaneity of the Olympic Games, the mass scale of the enterprise itself, and the high idealism and ritual that surround the Olympics give it pride of place among international sporting events. Indeed, it's the only sporting event in the United States whose television audience almost accurately represents the demographics of the American viewer audience. And no other sporting event's even close. It's always gender skewed. Men love to watch sports. But the Olympics is the television sporting event that everybody watches across all kinds of social barriers and lines. In fact, I'd go even further in a sense talking about the significance of the Olympics and say that on the world stage, the Olympics are the cultural gathering place of the global community. There is no institution or cultural practice, not from the UN or UNESCO or any NGO, that even comes close to bringing the people of the world together. And that gives it an unbelievable power and extraordinary significance. Now, I could go on about this for a long time. Mary Jo and I taught a class on this once. We didn't go to Beijing on that one, but I guess I want to say just a little bit about the Beijing Olympics because that's what I've been focused on recently. I got interested in the Beijing Olympics not just to go to Beijing, but because of the human rights issues that surrounded the awarding of Beijing with the Games in the first place. A lot of my research has been about race and sports and civil rights and human rights, and so I was very interested in what was happening with the bid and the Games in Beijing. What I found out, actually, and this is what I've been researching and thinking about, is that the Chinese don't have any illusions that their games were about human rights, but they do have some very high ideals about what they call the humanist games. Now, I'm not going to get lost in that, but I can tell you it's a very distinctive vision of the social power and ideology of global sport. It's one that emphasizes mass participation, both in terms of athletic participation and in terms of spectatorship and fandom. It emphasizes social harmony and political order, especially the collective aspects of human life and not the individualistic ones that we in the West tend to highlight. And it also takes very seriously the idea of development and economic development in and through international sport. One of the reasons why China and its Olympic bid was so successful on the international stage is that countries in Africa and Latin America and other parts of Asia really believe and see a possibility in the ideals that the Chinese have about the Olympics that's quite different from those that we in the West have held. A couple points I'll make about that. One, and it's not entirely great. I mean, there's some scary, concerning things about the Chinese ideology. The emphasis on order and stability is particularly can be particularly aggressive in a political sense. The emphasis on their own nationalism and place in the international world is something that's rightly got a lot of attention. But I want to say three things about all that. One is that the Chinese are no different than any other host nation in politicizing the games and using the games for political purpose. We act like they're the first, but in fact, when the United States has hosted the games, whether it was in Atlanta or Los Angeles, the most recent ones, it was a big political event to celebrate American patriotism and nationalism. A second point is that the ideas of a humanist games from Beijing really are an alternative to how we in the West tend to think about the power, the progress, the potentials of sport on an international stage. And third, the one that's probably the most important, is the seriousness with which they take the ideas about development, about helping out countries that are poorer, that are less disadvantaged, and using sport not just to celebrate the elites, but to build up countries that haven't been fully at the stage, on the international stage. Now, the other thing that's unique about the Chinese Games, and this will bring us to our theme, is the gender dynamics that we've seen in Chinese Olympic contexts. I guess, in particular, what's important to know is that women in China have been tremendously successful as Olympians, and not as a Title IX enterprise, but from the very beginning of China coming back into the global Olympic competition. Chinese women were well represented on all teams, in fact, dominant in some ways. They led the medal counts and have now for 20 years within China. Women were winning the medals. They won international championships, and they won the championships around volleyball in particular, but some other sports as well in the 1980s that really brought patriotism and pride back to China. And the women that were on those teams were national heroes in ways that there was no male equivalence because there wasn't any success among the men in China. And these women were heroes then, and they're still heroes now. A lot of them moved into politics. They've moved into places of tremendous influence and prominence. Those of you who are following the U.S. Olympic volleyball team know that the American coach was one of the stars on that team in the 1980s that won 5 world championships, taking down the Soviet Union, Japan, and the United States along the way. Tremendous revival of national pride around these women. Now, it's an interesting story of why. I won't go into the details. I'll tell you a couple of the outlines. Susan Brownell, who we had here a few years ago, is one of the people who's really researched this. If you're interested in all this, her recent book, Beijing Games, What the Olympics Mean to China, talk about a lot of this. But the reasons for success, part of it was a socialist kind of ideology that treated men and women equally. But that wasn't the only thing. It was also the fact that in China, sports had a historically low status. It was a peasant activity. So men didn't really care that much about who was playing sports and who wasn't. There wasn't the attempt to dominate and control and keep one population out of participation. And as well, there's a history in China of the woman warrior. You probably know it best through the Mulan Disney movie, but it's a real cultural tradition about women taking the lead in fighting for the nation that provides quite a different context for both the success, the opportunities for success for women in sport, and the ways in which they're meaningful and what they mean to the country. Now, this is all interesting stuff. I encourage you to think about it, to think more. We're not going to talk about all this tonight. This is context to help set for you how this can be different in other countries, to help give you some background, a backdrop against which to imagine and perhaps better understand what's unique and particular about women Olympians in the United States. And that's what I'd like to do now is invite our panelists up. I'll introduce them in a moment, and we will then embark upon a conversation about their experiences and understandings as Olympians here in the United States. I'm going to introduce all of them first, a little brief background, and then I've got a list of questions that it's not just my questions, it's one that the Tucker team helped pull together. We'll use those to guide the conversation for a while, and hopefully it'll become conversational, but we will start, after I introduce them, they'll each do a little bit of a kind of narrative of their own pathway in Olympic sport. Our first guest is Janis Klecker, who competed in the 1992 Olympic Marathon in Barcelona, Spain, the same year that she won the Olympic trials. A native of Edina and a 2-time alumni of the University of Minnesota as an undergraduate and the School of Dentistry, Klecker is a 5-time qualifier for the Olympic trials, Twin Cities Marathon champion, and winner of countless other races. Such achievements have earned her a place in the U.S. Track and Field Minnesota Hall of Fame. And currently, she holds the women's world record for the 50K, a record she's apparently held for over 25 years. So thanks for joining us. Our second guest is Carrie Tollefson, who began her career as a distance runner while growing up here in Dawson, Minnesota. She's a 13-time Minnesota State High School champion in both cross-country and track and field. At Villanova, Tollefson became a 5-time NCAA champion and 12-time All-American. During her post-collegiate career, she's won a national championship in both cross-country and indoor track. In the 2004 Olympics in Athens, Greece, she competed in the 1500-meter race after winning the American Olympic trials. Carrie, thanks. Our third panelist is Shani Marks, a native of Apple Valley, and a 3-time All-American triple jumper and NCAA runner-up while competing for the U of M. Marks is also 2-time defending national champion in the indoor and outdoor triple jump, the reigning Olympic trials champion for the United States, and she just represented the United States in the triple jump at the Beijing Olympic Games. Marks is currently in her 4th season as volunteer track and field coach for the U of M. Along with Carrie, I understand she's training for the 2012 Games in London. Thank you, Shani. All right, so I'm going to start us off now and ask each of the panelists to give us about 5 minutes. And I was told to be strict on time, and I have no idea how much I took, so maybe, I don't know if that was a mistake. Anyway, and what I want each of you to do, if you can, is to take us in about 5 minutes, if possible, on your pathway to the Olympics, highlighting key moments in your athletic careers that helped bring you to the Games. Janis, you want to start us off?
I never thought I would feel like the old one in the group, but I am. I think Shani told me she was 12 in 1992 when I ran the marathon. So I began running actually when I was 19. I would never ran as a track runner in high school, and I use that as a way to encourage younger people that they don't have to start running when they're 3 and 4 and think that they're going to make an Olympic team. But I started when I was 19, really to stay fit with no idea what God had in store for me and no vision of making an Olympic team. My vision really eventuated as I achieved some success. I was very much motivated by running faster. I was gifted with a good biomechanical form, and so I was able to run pretty much injury-free for years and was able to improve in just road racing. Ran one season of cross-country at the University of Minnesota, but was never one of the top runners at the U. Really competed mostly on my own in road races. The women's marathon, and the first marathon I ran was in 1979. You weren't born that, were you?
I was. I was two.
So, and I actually was Janice Horns at the time, and I ran 2 hours and 58 minutes in my first marathon, and the winner of that marathon was Barney Klecker. Who'd have thought? So after that, we started dating anyway. I was very much motivated by success, and that, I don't want to talk about that. and just by continuing to improve, and that's what provides a lot of us with motivation. And in 1984, the marathon was added to the Olympics. That was the first year that women could run the marathon in the Olympics. And so that provided me with a vision and a motivation to make that part of my goal. I did compete in the Olympic trials in 1984. I had a stress fracture 6 weeks before the trials. And in order to make an Olympic team, some of you might not know this, but you have to go to an Olympic trials. You have to place first, second, or third in that trials race, and then you get to go to the Olympic Games. Everyone else goes home. And so it really boils down to having a good race on that day. And no road to the Olympics is very smooth. I think all three of us can say that it's a bumpy road, and to say the least. So I competed in 84 and then also in 88. I was in dental school at the time and married with no children. Was very much able to focus on my running. In 1988, I also had an injury, wasn't able to run. So 92, I was out of dental school, and I was able to focus on my training. But there comes a point in your running, I think, where pursuing any goal where it feels like it's a very selfish thing. You put a lot of things in your life on hold. You spend a lot of time by yourself training and very focused on your own goals. And I felt like it was sort of a lot of selfish motivation. And I was talking to a woman about that, and I was telling her about how I trained. And I said, you know, I run about 80 to 90 miles a week, and I lift weights and I swim and I bike and do track workouts and hill workouts. And she said, you know, Janis, just the motivation to do and train like that is a gift. And I had never thought of it that way before. I always thought that given enough time, anyone would want to run 80 to 90 miles a week. And so that really changed my focus on why I was running and that there was a higher purpose and a greater purpose for what I was doing. And so when I started the Olympic trials race in 1992, I was very fit physically, I was very fit emotionally, and very fit spiritually. And it was a wonderful thing to have all of those things come together and to have a support system there, my parents, my husband, and a few friends that were able to watch. And at about 15 miles into the race, I got tripped. And I, that's what I said. And, bummer. And the press truck, I was not in the lead, but I was with the lead pack, and they're like, oh, Klecker's down, Klecker's down. And I was on the pavement at 15 miles in the race, and Kathy O'Brien turned around and kind of grabbed me and pulled me back up. And I ran for about another half mile, and Leslie Lehane, who was in the race, said, come on, Janis, get back in the race. And I won the race. And those words still ring so true to me. Come on, Janis, get back in the race. So that was the pinnacle of my athletic career. None of us won medals in the games, but all of us won the Olympic trials. So victory, a small victory, a huge victory just to get to the games. I've had the luxury of living 16 years since then, so I could go on for a half an hour about about what I've learned from those games and how many times I've had to remember, come on, Janis, get back in the race. So I still run, I still stay fit. My marathons are different these days. I now have 6 children. And if all I had to do was run a marathon, my life would be very simple. So I've learned many, many lessons from that experience. And I think as time has gone by, I've grown to appreciate it much, much more. Running still is just a celebration of my heart, and I'm very thankful for the experience I had.
Thank you. Carrie.
Well, I just want to say that Janis, she fixes my teeth, and to be able to go out and have her work on me, I don't go as much as she wants me to go, but I'm in awe of her, and I just look at her, and I'm like, oh, and I have to do that the whole time I'm out there at her, you know, with her at her office, but, you know, she has been someone that I've been able to look up to, and she wears her Olympic earrings, and I don't know if you wear them every day, but I've seen her wearing them, and it was so much fun to be able to talk to her before the Olympics and after, and hear about how important this is for all of us to believe we can achieve our dreams. And not only has Janis been a huge role model for me in my career, but I have my 91-year-old grandma in the crowd. Grandma wave. Yeah. My mom and my husband and my mother-in-law, and you know, I think all of us can attest that we wouldn't be here today if it weren't for our support system. So, maybe the best moment of my career so far is being able to share everything I have been able to share with my family. So, you know, I'm not going to get choked up because I'm one of those people, most of you know who know me, know I can cry at the drop of a dime. But, I started running in the 7th grade. I was a little bit younger than Janis when I started running. I was 12 years old. And I'm from a really small town of Dawson, Minnesota. I don't know if a lot of you know where that is, but it's out by the hump of Minnesota on the left-hand side. And, it's, for me, I think a lot of it started growing up in a small community. And, you know, we had a weight room, but the weight room is still the same as it is, you know, as it was when I think maybe my mom and dad moved there. You know, there wasn't a lot of stuff there, but we made it work. And Nikki Swenson's in the crowd right now. She was someone that I saw as a little girl playing t-ball, and I got to coach her, and now she's running for the U of M, and, you know, those are the moments for me. Yeah, making the Olympic team is amazing, but the moments that, you know, I get to watch now, being an athlete and being able to come back to the community and see people like that continue to strive and believe in their dreams, that's what's been amazing. But, you know, I did go through high school and competed, and, you know, like you said, I won some state championships here, went to Villanova, and I see Gary Wilson's in the crowd. And one thing I do want to tell you guys, even if he was here or not, the first person I called when I knew I was going to go, I called Gary and I said, Gary, I have the opportunity to run for Villanova and I have the opportunity to run for you and I'm going to go for this. I'm going to go away from home. I'm going to try and see what it's like to get out of this, you know, little town that I'm from. And he said, Carrie, if you're not going to come here, I don't know if you remember saying this, Gary, but he said, I couldn't choose a better school for you. So for him to have given me the support from day one meant so much. And he knows every time I came to any of my NCAA races or any of the meets that we got to see the Gophers at, he was the first guy or the maroon and gold I'd go and give a hug to and say, oh, Minnesota. And, you know, to be able to move back here in 2001 and compete as a pro, it's been a dream come true. I bleed Minnesota, and I love it here. And I think we have so many great gifts to go and share with the world. And, you know, our personalities and just the support that we give each other, I think it's been amazing. And so, you know, going on and winning the Olympic trials and placing 14th at the Olympics, I was the second person out of the final. That's been amazing. But like I said, meeting these people and having the support has been the highlight of my career. So I hope to continue on in 2012. Who knows if that will happen. Like Janis said, bumps come get in the way a lot of times, and I've been there with injuries. I didn't make the last team because of an injury, but I hope to get back there. And you know, it's just been an amazing ride. I love that I've had this passion and drive and a God-given ability to run as fast as I can. I always laugh that I wonder if Charlie, my husband, ever knew he would marry someone that could make such fast left turns and run in circles so fast. But we've had an amazing ride together, and it's been a blast. So hopefully we'll be able to share some more experiences with you tonight.
Well, thank you guys for having me here today. I actually grew up in Apple Valley, Minnesota, and started out, my dream when I was little was to go to the Olympics, but as a gymnast. So turned out a little bit differently than I had planned, but I grew up doing gymnastics from when I was probably 3 up through high school. And when I got to high school, my mom very strongly encouraged me to run track. And I kind of fought it. I wasn't really sure if that was going to be my thing, but eventually I grew to love it. So I started running track in high school, and I started out as a sprinter and long jumper. And I'm glad Wilson is here.
Everyone loves you, Wilson.
They recruited me to come to the U to be an occasional 4x4 runner and do long jump. Well, by the end of my career, I was 600, 400 hurdles, triple jump, long jump, 4x1, 4x4. I know. So I came and I started triple jumping, I think, my 3rd year there. And it was a new event for me, and with all my events that I did, that was definitely my favorite, but they wouldn't let me let go of the other ones, so I did them all. And the coach that I had when I was originally there wasn't very big on field events. It was more about on the track, so I didn't work very much on my triple jump. I just kind of did what he needed me to do, what the team needed me to do. My senior year, we ended up getting a new coach who liked triple jump. So that was, you know, probably 20, and it was the first time I'd ever actually gone to a practice and did triple jump. Normally it was, okay, there's a meet, Shani, go triple jump, and I was like, okay. So that was really the turning point for me in my athletic career was having him come to the U, and I saw the pattern that, you know, if you work on triple jump, you jump further. So every meet, you know, I was jumping further than the meet before. And before I knew it, I had qualified for, this was 2003, and I had qualified for 2004 trials, which it wasn't on the radar for me. It just kind of happened. And so I thought, well, might as well do that, right? So I graduated, and actually I had the first 3 years probably out of college were really, really tough to be, you know, training on your own and not have that team there for you. But I competed at the 2004 trials and competed decent, and I got fourth. And at that moment, I was like, well, we're going to go to 2008. I mean, I got fourth, and I didn't even, you know, do that great. And so I continued training for another 4 years, and I always tell people it took me, from when I graduated, it took me 3 years to even jump as far as I had in college. So it was rough, mm-hmm. as you guys know. And so I had the, I guess the this past year was a challenge because, as you guys know, and as everybody knows, you have to be top three at the trials, but you also have to have a qualifying mark. And if you don't have that, you can win, and it doesn't matter. So that was my stress for the year. And every time I thought about that, I kind of freaked out a little bit. I was a little bit of a crazy person this past year, if anyone was around me. So that was my challenge, and it was like, it was more mental training than anything this past year, because I knew that it was going to be the mental training that brought me through, regardless of, I knew I was going to be physically ready. So I, you know, tried to keep that focus on the goal as opposed to focusing on whatever your, you know, my current circumstances were, regardless of how I was jumping, which I was, you know, I was jumping well this past year, but it was not where it needed to be. It was consistently good, but not great. So so it was a lot of mental training. I went to the trials and ended up winning the trials. Probably the most overwhelming joy I've felt. So, and like you said, you know, having the family there just made it that much better. And I think there was about a 6-week separation from the trials through to the Olympics. And it was hard to come down from that kind of emotional high that you're on. So I struggled with that a little bit and went out to the Olympics. And we were out there about 2 weeks early. And you're throwing me off here. and again, competed. And, you know, of course, like you guys were saying, we've had better meets than we did at the Olympics. And I'm, the Olympics was a blessing, and I'm so thankful for that experience. But the journey is what I'll always remember. Mm-hmm. So.
Thanks. You guys are making it easy. Shani, you already started to allude to it. We had a couple questions about the Olympic experience that we wanted to ask, and it doesn't have to be in order now. If you want to jump in and talk together on this as well, that's fine. The first one is just, could you each say a few words about what was your own memorable Olympic experience or moment? And it could be competitively, or it could be just being at the Olympics. Anything particularly memorable?
When I was there, it was always, I wanted to take in every moment. So kind of like when people say you get married, it goes quick. And I was, we would be going on to the bus to practice, and I was like, I don't want to forget anything. I'm looking out the window, you know, like I'm in Beijing. You know, I'm watching the security on the street. Like, I just want to take pictures of every second. So I was doing that the entire time I was there. But for me, I think it was probably the opening ceremonies and just that first moment walking into the auditorium, the Bird's Nest, where track was held, you know, was about almost 100,000 people seated in there. And, you know, the United States, we had the biggest delegation. So when we walked in there, it was like, USA, like 100,000 people. And I was just in awe of that. And that was probably the first moment where I was like, I'm at the Olympics right now. So that was probably my favorite and most memorable experience.
Quick follow-up. Did you get to see, like, how much of the ceremonies do you get to see as athletes? The opening ceremonies in particular, because you're not out on the field to see a lot of what we're seeing on TV.
Yeah.
What are you doing during that time?
We are, we were in the gymnastics stadium, and the screen would go back and forth between showing us what was going on in the stadium, and then they would flash your country by number to, you know, that you would have to line up to go out. So it went back and forth, so we saw bits and pieces of it. But I had buy the DVD and watch it just like everyone else.
You're just hanging out in a big auditorium with your team and taking pictures of other teams. And, you know.
we were in a holding pattern, same thing, in an auditorium, so you really don't get to see a lot of it. And then they line you up, and you stand for a long time waiting to march in. And I just remember, as we were standing up, the dream team flew in a helicopter. They were not in a holding pattern like the rest of us athletes.
They were standing. We actually, well, I'm glad you said that, because we actually had the basketball players behind us. And I tell a lot of kids at my camp or wherever that the thing that, you know, I remember the most was LeBron James was right behind me, and Allen Iverson and all these other guys. And, you know, all the distance runners were in front of them. And we're not, I mean, there was a couple of us that aren't too short, but there were, you know, there's some of us that are pretty short. And I remember thinking, oh, my gosh, I'm, like, bawling walking into the stadium. And I look back, and LeBron James is bawling. And I was like, oh, my gosh, this multimillionaire, this huge man, is just as emotional about making the Olympic team as I am. So that was pretty cool.
I didn't mean that to be your own moment or experience. So was there other things about the Olympic experience that you wanted to highlight?
I can share just real quick. One, I think the whole Olympic experience to me was very humbling. Because when you win the Olympic trials, you very much have a feeling like you're the top of your game that year, and you are the best runner or triple jumper in that event for the year. But when you get to the Olympics, there's over 10,000 athletes, and they're all the best, too. So it was a very humbling feeling to me to get there. And then to go into the Olympic Village, and people were asking me if I was a synchronized swimmer. And I'm like, no, I'm the best woman marathoner in the USA last year. So.
I love
don't
it.
You know? And so,
so
I think that was one of the highlights. Was it was really a very humbling thing, that you know, just to be there and to be amongst so many good athletes. The highlight for real highlight for me though was that in order to go to the opening ceremonies, we are each given one ticket for ourselves and one ticket for somebody else. And I was there with my husband and my mom and my dad and two friends. And the tickets, people were scalping them for like $600-$700 at the outside the gate. And we were being on the track and field team, our event didn't start until the middle of the Olympic Games. So there were several track and field athletes who had not arrived yet. And so the team manager, she said, "Now you just wait, I might be able to get you tickets." Because a lot of the athletes had not come in, so she had the tickets that would have gone to those athletes, and all of my family got to see the opening ceremonies. Cool. And I ran out of that Olympic Village with these tickets, and it was just like, that was my medal right there.
I too kind of had a humbling moment. I was with the, what happens when you go to the Olympics is they have the actual Olympic Village that we stay in, but also the U.S. and I think different countries have personal training, or not personal, but like team training venues. And I went to one of our the team training venues, and I was with all the wrestlers, which was kind of fun because a lot of them knew the U of M wrestlers, or they knew Augsburg, or they knew of Iowa, or, you know, just people from the Midwest. And I was talking to one of the trainers. They have, each wrestler brings a guy to train with, or you know, spar, whatever that would be called. No. Sorry, I'm not a wrestler. But so they would bring somebody to train with. And I was talking to one of the guys, and I saw Rulon Gardner. Is that Gardner, how you say it? I saw him walk by, and I remember him from, you know, putting his shoes on the mat and doing all this stuff at the Olympics. And I was like, oh, he's an Olympian. And the guy, the trainer said to me, "You know what, girl? You better look in the mirror because so are you." And I was, that moment for me, I mean, I knew I was obviously going to the Olympics, but for him to, like, I saw Olympians walking all over the place, and that was really neat for me.
That's good. We couldn't have written better stuff than that. We want to ask a question about what competing in the Olympics meant to you as an athlete, as an American, and as a woman. So I want to open that up. You don't have to do one or the other of those, but I guess I'd be particularly interested in, you know, it's a global stage, and do you think of yourself as representing folks, and how conscious of you are that, and how does that affect your experience and your performance and the whole thing? So, woman, citizen, but do you think of other folks, or is it really about you, or how does that go?
I'll start. Yeah. No one's looking eager. I think for me, I don't think I went into it, you know, necessarily thinking, oh, I'm representing the United States of America. But when I reflect back to that moment of the opening ceremonies, you know, and our huge delegation from the United States, I think I've never worn USA with the pride that I did that day. And then hearing the people just chanting, I think that was the first time that I was like, wow, I am, you know, representing the country. And also when I got back, I think it hit me even more so because people were so proud that I represented the United States. So so I definitely, I didn't go into it, you know, with that as my focus, but I really was proud to be an American when I was there, for sure.
But so. You didn't start with it.
I didn't start. And it's hard with track because we're not, you know, we're one of the few people out there that we're not, I mean, we're a team, but we're not. Mm-hmm. You know, everyone trains somewhere different. Everyone has their different events. Everyone's doing their different thing. So you don't necessarily get that team aspect, and we're all used to kind of working on our own. So it took me being in that setting, that team setting, to feel like, wow, we are representing the United States. We're all here for the same reason, you know, and we all have these goals. And, you know, and it starts to, they in the village, they keep a chart with like a medal count, and there's a publication that goes out every day in the village saying, oh, this is how everyone did in all the different sports yesterday, this is what's happening today. And you really found yourself really getting into that and really cheering for these people that you don't necessarily know, but you know that they're kind of in the same boat as you are. So it became more of a team aspect than I would have imagined it would be.
I think one thing I thought of was just being from that small town in Minnesota. I had a lot of emails. I mean, I didn't even know a lot of people knew how to email that, you know, that were, some of these older people were emailing me over there, and you know, they just remember me when I was this, you know, little girl with mall bangs and buck teeth, and you know, but I think that's the stuff that, you know, yeah, we were representing the U.S., and we were representing ourselves and, you know, our colleges or whatever that may be, but I think it was really neat to have Dawson Boyd say, you know, there's this girl from farm country, you know, and she believed she could do it, and my friends believed I could do it, and my, you know, teammates and everyone, they really appreciated the fact that I worked hard as a, you know, as a 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th grader, 12th grader, and that was kind of cool, to be from small town America, and to be all the way over in Athens, where it all began, the Olympics began in Athens, and so I did carry that with me. And I remember my dad saying, when you get out on that track, just take a moment, like you were having those moments, just take a moment and realize where you're at. And that was when I thought of Dawson and, you know, just all these little things along the way, and that was pretty cool.
Anything like that for you?
Well, I think I can speak to it a little bit, maybe from just being a woman at the Olympics. And I think that at the time that I started running, there really were not that many women running marathons. In 1979, I don't know how many women were entered in the City of Lakes Marathon, which now has eventuated into Twin Cities Marathon, but there wasn't very many. I mean, I was third place with 2:58, which wouldn't place at any marathon now for sure. So I think that just being a woman and sort of being somewhat feeling like a pioneer in the sport, and especially my mom, who ran many marathons. She started running when she was 43, and she ran 40 marathons. So she's kind of the matriarch of distance running in the Minneapolis area. So I think that just then starting running and that at that young, you know, early stage, and as distance running was becoming popular, and then going on to make an Olympic team, really gave some credibility to women's distance running. And I think also just personally, as we make an Olympic team, somehow it gives you, people listen to what you say. like, I'm an Olympian, so I must know something about running. And so I think people, they have a certain level of respect for what you have achieved in your sport. And so I think that we carry with us even 16 years later. I mean, for me, I will never run as fast as I did then. And so it's very much history for me, even though I still run. but not to compete. So I think as a woman being early on in the stages of distance running and then going on to represent the women's distance running in the Olympics was really something very special.
At that, yeah. On the gender front, anything for Carrie or Shani?
Well, I think for us, we have had so many pioneers before us, I guess. I would have to say that probably a little bit even, because I'm just a little bit older than Shani, but, you know, Title IX and all that stuff it's done so much for us and the opportunities that we as women can do. I mean, I don't know how many times I've said to these young guys that, you know, my husband, I don't know if he thought he'd ever marry a pro athlete as a female, you know, and I tell all you young guys, like, it's not just the guys that can pretend they are, you know, the LeBron James on the basketball court. Us girls can believe that we can be the professional, you know, female athletes that are playing now and running now. And I think it's just an amazing time for us. And, you know, I mean, everywhere, politics everywhere. But, you know, these women are the ones that really, you know, we see you in your Reebok uniform. Well, those were the first people that were sponsored. You know, and now this is what I do for a living. This is how Charlie and I, you know, he's an architect and I'm an athlete. And it's so much fun that I get to use my passion and not have to just pretend I'm going to be, I used to say I was Michael Jordan on the basketball court, you know. Now I can pretend I'm a female. So it's, I did bring that with me. I can pretend I'm a girl. I am one, but...
Kind of following on that, were any of you able to talk with women from other countries about their experiences, their understandings, and how it might compare or contrast with some of what you were just talking about?
I'll just share on that a little bit because we had sort of a funny experience with that, in that we used to sit in the food service at the Olympic Village and we'd play Guess Your Sport. And, and we'd look around and, well, you know, she might be in rowing or whatever, you know. So, and people would ask me that all the time. Well, did you get to know any of the other runners there and stuff? And it's not like you're going to camp. You're not there really to build relationship with people that are there, and especially being on the track and field team, because we aren't really a team. All of us have competed, you know, in our certain events, have competed against each other, and we all had to compete against each other to make the Olympic team. And so even though there's a sense of camaraderie once you make the team, it still is a very, very individual sport, because they don't really even score the track and field team as a team. It's all just individual events. So even though you might be exposed to a lot of different athletes, you still really, I felt, stayed very much with the country and with the athletes that, you know, that we were. So in my experience, it wasn't. Occasionally you would, but like I said, it wasn't like being at camp where you were really out there to mingle with the other athletes.
Shani and Carrie, is it similar?
Yeah, it's similar. I would say, I don't know that I can speak of a conversation, but I was very... Observative, is that a word? Well, we'll make it one if it isn't. the other triple jumpers, because they're people that, you know, I see at other international competitions, and I just, you know, they put us in this little holding room before they bring us out on the track, and I'm sitting here thinking, this is cool, I'm in Spain, or I'm in Japan, or I'm wherever I am, and I get to go out here and, you know, do something that I love to do. And you watch these other girls, and some of them, it's like, this is serious. Like, you don't have a choice. They have to be here. Them winning is a very serious thing, you know. And they're doing it because they have to. It's their survival, and that makes me very thankful, because I'm like, just watching them, like, God, that doesn't look like fun to me, you know. So, I mean, that's an observation that I had with my event and with the girls from the other countries.
So just how they are during the competition and how focused they are?
Well, yeah, I don't think it's a focus issue. I just think it's, they're doing it for different reasons. Hmm. So, and not necessarily why we participate in sports here. So.
We might have more opportunities to have a good life outside of, you know, if I decide tomorrow that it's time for me to become a mom, or me to become a dentist, or, you know, a sports broadcaster, whatever it may be. I think in the U.S., we can do that. But in other countries, you know, if you are a good runner and you're female, that might be the only thing that you can do, and your country will make you do it until you cannot do it anymore physically. And I do some TV broadcasting for different road races, and I've seen a lot of the Ethiopians come over and run our road races, and to see what they do with their prize money after a race or portions of it. They go and buy, you know, winter coats. They go and buy, you know, boots or electronics or things like that, and they bring all that home or they ship it all home. And, you know, it's you hate to say that what, you know, we do with our prize money or our, you know, contract money is different. I don't think that, you know, we have a different lifestyle here, but it's pretty amazing to see how many people they can feed with their one race or how many cows they can buy for a family or whatever it may be. And so, yeah, there are different aspects to the sport.
Okay, I want to push on this a little bit and go off script, but Nicole, it'll be okay. I was just curious, though, because a couple of you alluded to kind of the solitary nature of training here, and you're kind of on your own, especially once you're out of college. And it seems to me like that might be another way that it's somewhat different from these other countries that you're describing. Did you pick up on that at all? I mean, the way that their training works, is it more team-oriented? Are they kind of as alone and isolated as you might feel, especially once you leave college?
I felt like they're definitely more team-oriented. I think that, part of the problem is that we're all training in Minnesota, and it's not a real big track mecca. you know, so I...
It's okay, Wilson.
Sorry. As far as post-collegiate training here is what I'm saying. And, if you're post-collegiate and you're a sprinter, you find a group in Florida or California and no problem. So I think that, in other countries you find a lot more all the jumpers from Cuba train with this guy. And, you know, so I think they probably do have more of a team aspect than we do here.
Although America is huge. And, you know, some of these countries, they have, you know, just, it's not nearly as big of a country. So for us, you know, Minnesota is as big as some of these countries. So it can be hard for us to all train together. And that's the thing. I mean, making the American Olympic team is probably, I mean, I'd say one of maybe three or four of the hardest teams to make because we have so many good athletes from here. So, you know, I train with a group called Team USA Minnesota, and there's about six women and about eight men, and we've all decided to move back here and train. And yeah, distance runners have to train in the snow and the ice and the wind, and you know, that's why the girls are ranked in the top five in the country right now at the U of M. I mean, that's, we're tough. And so, you know, we can handle it, right, girls? So, but, you know, yeah, I mean, there's groups, but probably not as strict as other countries.
I meant to follow up on this a minute ago. So it sounded like there wasn't as much as I might have thought, but people often are really curious who haven't been to the Olympics about life in the villages.
Did you stay in the village?
I did.
Stay in the village? Is there anything you can share with us about that? Or
did you say?
Yeah. I'll share why I didn't stay in the village, okay? the Olympic Village was a beautiful spot, and it had everything you would want as far as food and accommodations and stuff to get your hair cut and play games and everything. But I went over there. It's a little difficult to go over there if you want to go over there other than just yourself. And I wanted to be with my husband and with my parents and with a couple friends. And so I had a bed in the Olympic Village in an apartment that was not air-conditioned with, like, seven other women. And even though it was a great spot, it probably wasn't the best place for me to be if I was hoping to run the race of my life, you know, a few days later. So we actually stayed outside of Barcelona for a little while. And then this was totally an answered prayer. There was a hotel going up right across the street from the Olympic Village that was going to be a Ritz-Carlton, and it hadn't fully opened yet because they didn't have all the bells and whistles up to stuff. And so my husband is in the hotel and restaurant industry, and he was talking with the general manager, and they ended up actually opening this hotel for the Olympics, and several of the athletes actually ended up staying in this beautiful hotel. We had a 22nd room floor suite. One side overlooked the Mediterranean, and the other side overlooked the Olympic Village. So I had the luxury of going into the Olympic Village and experiencing Olympic Village life, but actually sleeping in across the street. And it turned out that pretty soon we saw like Pete Sampras there, and a bunch of the track and field runners were kind of catching wind of this place that they could stay that was actually very reasonably priced right across from the village. So the village was a wonderful place to be, but maybe not always conducive to your best athletic performance.
Now, you guys both stayed at the village?
Yep.
Anything to share from that?
I had a great time in the village. I was kind of in awe. The cafeteria for us, as you guys probably remember, is like the size of Costco, probably. And so I don't know when you can ever be in a place and hear like seven languages at once. So that was, I was kind of in awe of that all the time. And then also playing the game, what sport is that person? What sport is that person? And it was really just a great experience to get to like walk around the village and see. Like, I kind of like you were saying, I would see someone and I'd be like, I know them. And then I would start talking to them. Nope, I don't know them. I've seen them play on TV or whatever. Like, just kidding. But I thought it was a, it was, that was part of my experience, honestly. Really just getting to bond with your teammates and the other track and field athletes. And, you know, we'd hang out. Like, it's its own little city, you know. So there's movie theaters and internet cafes and everything possibly that you would ever need or want. And those moments, those were fun, like hanging out with my teammates and you know, in the arcade playing basketball. That was part of my experience. So I was thankful to have been there. It was fun.
One of the questions we had was about, you know, someone like me, I study like a lot of the controversies and the politics that surround the Olympics, and sometimes the coverage has a lot of those kind of aspects of storylines. How aware of politics or controversies that might go on during the games are you as a competitor? Are you picking up on that at all, or is it really focused on your competitions? If you're picking up on it, what are you hearing? How do you learn about that?
Well, when we were going to Athens, you know, it was obviously a pretty scary time, and they're really concerned. I mean, it and you know, as they are probably for every Olympics. But I think for me, I was finally like hearing, you know, learning a little bit more about the news and paying a little bit more attention to it because I was getting a little older. And I was pretty scared just because they were saying, you know, there's going to be Secret Service around. There's going to be, you know, at the Olympic Village, there'll be armed guards for you. Like, just don't worry, you're not, you know, in any danger. And they kind of scared us. I guess, you know, They should have, because I'm this naive little girl, like, you know, running around Greece by myself and thinking everyone's as nice as I am. And but I remember about, one thing I remember about the Olympic Village, and, you know, my husband and my mom and dad came in one day and saw it, but we couldn't wear our USA stuff, and they still, you know, encourage us not to do it. And I thought that, you know, it kind of stinks that we can't do that, you know. I think we're all proud to wear, you know, what we're representing, but in the Olympic Village, we couldn't have any flags out of our windows. We couldn't have any, like, eagles or, you know, anything that represented the U.S. And so they didn't want to draw any attention to us. Well,
this is the USOC?
Yes, USOC, you know, IOC, everyone.
Okay.
Everyone, International Olympic Committee, for those of you who don't know what IOC is. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, just things, just everyone was worried about us. And it was every other, by the end of the Olympics, every other dorm or every other apartment complex had their flags hanging out, had their national symbols, except the Americans. So it was like we were the sore thumb. Like if anyone wanted to bomb us, you know where to go. We have the guy with the machine, you know, gun standing outside of our apartment complexes. So I felt the politics. I felt the, you know, fear for the Americans. But, you know, we were thankful. And actually when we were in Crete, which, did you guys go early and stay for a week beforehand outside of the village? Or
I didn't.
No.
Did you guys?
Yeah.
So you go and stay and then come into the city. And we had, by the end of it, I knew, I was like, that guy's been following us, going to pizza, going on our runs, whatever, and he was our Secret Service. So, you know, and he's, by the end, he's like, hey, I'm that guy, like, watching every move you make, you know? So yeah, we felt it, but they were just trying to protect mm-hmm. us.
Shani, what about in Beijing? Was it a sense
mine was almost identical to what mm-hmm. she was saying. We would notice someone following us, and they didn't tell us mm-hmm. that, you know, these people are going to be your security and they're going to be following you. There just happens to be someone follows us everywhere we go. So I felt safe at every moment because we had that security. I never felt scared, but the same thing, wherever we go internationally as a USA team for track and field, they tell you not to wear USA stuff on the plane, don't wear it outside of the village. I agree with you. It's kind of sad because you want it. You're proud of that, and you're proud to represent the United States. But I guess they feel that that kind of puts a target on our backs. So, but outside of that, I think that we really do try to keep our focus on the reason that we're there, and that's to compete. Mm-hmm. But that's just kind of a sad mm-hmm. side note.
Yeah. I want to talk just a little bit about the post-Olympic experience and lessons from all this before we open it up. And could you, if you would, just a little bit about what kind of reflecting back the Olympics experience has meant to you as a person in your life, as it shaped your life that you're currently leading. You guys might have started to talk about that a bit before, but is there any things in particular? Shani, for you, it's pretty recent,
yeah.
So I don't know how.
Mine's very recent. But in the short, what has it been, 2 months? I think that, and I've always said this from the beginning, that it's always, you know, I didn't have the performance that I wanted, but it always has been, you know, about the journey and why are, you know, I think someone alluded to it earlier. It's not, you know, you get to the Olympics and it's not about winning or losing or even how you perform, but what did you represent when you were out there? So for me, you know, what did you learn? My mom used to, after every competition, she'd say, well, what did you learn? You know, and I would be so, you know, it'd be bad. So I didn't want to, like, talk about it. I'm like, I don't want to talk about something positive right now. But really, I carry that with me all the time because that's what it's about. What did you learn, and who did you become because of that? So,
man, I feel like I'm channeling your mom now or something. Sorry about that. What about you, Carrie?
You know, I was watching, as you were speaking before, I was watching you pretty intently, and I was going back to those 2 months of after the Olympics, and I could just see you, and I don't know if you were tearing up or if it was just, you know, the lights, but it's something that it's hard for us to even explain it. I think the joy that you feel being able to call yourself an Olympian. You know, I believed when I went to college I was going to be an NCAA champion, and then when I won that, I thought, okay, the next progression would be to make an Olympic team. And then when you get there, it's like you can't even hardly explain it. And it's been, you will have so much fun. You know, I mean, it was hard for me to sit home last year and watch the team when I felt like I belong there. And I felt like I'm just as talented as anybody on that team. I thought I should have been there. And it was hard because I was injured and, you know, all this stuff. But to be able to call myself an Olympian for the rest of my life is just a dream come true. And I really, really hope that if there's anyone in the crowd that really, really thinks they can do it or has even just a tiny, tiny wish that they could do it, that they really go for it. Because, yeah, there's only three people every 4 years on one day that make the team. But if you do, it changes your life forever. So, you know, Shani's just in the early stages, like being the newlywed of this. But it gets better and better and better. Mm-hmm. So it's been awesome.
You alluded to it a little bit before.
Yeah, I mean, I've had 16 years to think about it. So what it really did, one of the things it did, is it gives us a platform to share, and that people want to listen to our story. And our stories go so much beyond our performance. And so I have seen over the last 16 years how that one experience and the perseverance and the dedication that it took to get there has helped me in so many other areas of my life. And so I can reflect back on that and be so appreciative of it. And I ran the Olympic marathon on August 1st, 1992, and I had twins on July 24th, 1993. And I spent almost 10 weeks in bed
before I had them. And I think that people would say, you of all people, being on bed rest before you have twins, you know. And I was really good at being on bed rest because I knew how to focus and be very disciplined. And I had to lay on my left side and drink water. And I did it really well. And so I think that the dedication and the focus that you have to excel at a sport really carries over into so many other areas of your life. And so it's really been fun for me to reflect back on the last few years. And now having my own children in sport, I think one of the things I've learned is how joyful my parents must have felt when they saw me win the Olympic trials. Because I just saw my 15-year-old son run his cross-country race today. And he went from fifth runner on the team to second runner on the team in one meet. And so just the joy that I feel because of that, and not really pride, but just so joyful. And it gives me a little bit of a feeling for how my parents must have felt when they saw me cross the finish line. So those kind of experiences, I think, that go far beyond when someone asks me, what place did you get at the Olympics? You know, well, you know what? None of us had the race of our lives at the Olympics. I was 22nd place. And then I got listed in the finishers as 21st place because one of the women ahead of me tested positive for drugs. And
I would have been 10th. Yeah. Four girls got kicked out.
So anyway, I think, you know, it really isn't about the performance. When I got back from the Olympics, and a little bit of the state that Shani's in is it's sort of this euphoric state that you've sort of achieved this goal. Where do I go from here? And I didn't have the race of my life. I ran 2 hours and 47 minutes. I ran 17 minutes slower at the Olympics than I did at the Olympic trials. And I was clearly in better shape than that. So for me, I was able to then continue. And I ran Twin Cities Marathon, which would have then been in October after that. And one morning I was out on a run, and Barney had told me, my husband had told me, I should go out on a 17-mile run. And I came back after about 4 miles, and I was whining to him in the kitchen about how I didn't know what I wanted to do, and I was kind of discouraged. And then the doorbell rang, and it was this little neighbor girl, Erin, and she had made something for me. And it was a gold medal. It was a plastic gold medal. It was a craft that she had made, and she had put my name on it. And Barney looked at me, and he said, you know, that's why you run. And Erin was a six-year-old girl at the time, and she was at the bus stop. In the mornings, I'd go out, and I'd wave to her. And you know what? She ran Grandma's Marathon last year.
Oh, cool.
So that's what the Olympics does, you know, in the years down the road.
So that's the last actual question we had was advice you'd give. Carrie already alluded to a little bit, but young girls and maybe others who have Olympic aspirations, what do you tell them?
We're looking at you.
Okay. To get after it, to believe in themselves, to, you know, never say never. You know, my mom and dad said, they've told me for years that you can do what you put your mind to do. And they tell me that at the age of 31. They told me that at the age of 10, of 12, you know, whatever. And I believe them. And I think the main thing, though, that I really believe is you have to be kind to each other. And I think we all kind of seem like we have similar personalities where you are excited for people when they achieve things. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we were rooting for, you know, Shani and for Rasa Troop, who was running in the steeplechase this year over in Beijing. And, you know, it's amazing how much support we need to have from each other, but also to just recognize people are working hard. And I think if you guys can just continue to encourage each other, whether you're 60 years old or 16 years old, I think we can do amazing things as long as we have people on our side. So I do believe that you guys can do what you put your minds to. It's not going to be easy, and there will be ups and downs, but you might as well give it a try, because what's the other option? You know, not doing it, just floating through life, that's not going to be fun. So challenge yourself.
Janis?
Well, you also wrote down as parents what you would. So I'll speak to that a little
so
bit.
Parents,
and then also
right, sadly, I missed that line. Sorry.
My parents never told me to run. They were very encouraging, but they never told me to run. And so I think it really has to come from the child. And so I'm having to remember that with my own children. And but you know, it's joy to see them. And I called home, and on way home from the cross country meet, and my son John had run, and I said, "Well, is Sarah home?" And my little guy Joe said, "No, she just left on a run." I don't tell her to run. She just likes to run. She's 13. And the other thing I would give, advice I would give to young girls, or even not so young girls, about running is that I think it's as though God shines the flashlight one step ahead for us. And that when I started running around this little lake that we lived on, it was a mile around, and I used to have to walk part of the way, I had no idea that I would be on an Olympic team someday. And if that light would have been shined at the end of the tunnel, I would not have believed it. So I'm really thankful that you're just taken one step at a time, and that you're given one PR at a time, and you're given one track workout at a time. And if you just keep working at it one step at a time, it's amazing what can be done.
I don't know, Shani. It didn't sound like they were convinced you were ready to give advice yet, but did you have any?
Well, I work with a lot of athletes, like at the U, and also a lot of high school athletes. And I was telling these ladies earlier, I was asking Janis, I was like, do your kids think it's cool that that you're an Olympian? Because I was like, if my parents were Olympian, I'd be like all the time, like, did you know my dad's an Olympian? Did you know my mom's an Olympian? And part of the reason I don't have kids yet, but part of the reason I was so proud to have made the team, because I want my kids to say, you know, mm-hmm. to know that they can do anything.
All right, so I've been trying to follow our script here. We're out of questions, which is a good thing for you guys, because it's your opportunity to ask these wonderful women questions that you've been thinking about as you're sitting here listening to them and their talk about their experiences. We've got microphones in the back, so if you're interested, maybe raise your hand, and they'll bring the mics down to you.
But you held it together better.
Come on now. Here we no, I thought
no,
I saw him.
Just brushing your hair.
There's one, and over here, maybe that, here, and then back here.
Maybe this is for Janis more than the other two right now, but I'm curious, since you've had quite a few years to go into your dentistry and other things, the passion that you've had for your running, is it something that you have for now your dentistry or your parenting, or, I mean, I'm sure it's what carried you through so many, many tough times. I'd like to hear about that.
Yeah. I was running competitively while I was in dental school. And I really, really liked dentistry. I practiced part-time. And I used to tell people, running is my passion and dentistry is my job. But I also think that there's a lot of value in having pursued a career while I was running competitively, because it really kept me in touch with another side of life. And when I was in dental school, people would ask me, you know, why do you run? Why do you go out and run after class? Or why do you run in the lunch hour? Or why are you running home from school? Mm-hmm. Things like that. And I'd say, you know, it kind of keeps me in touch with reality. Because dental school is kind of a encompassing thing. And so it was really good for me to have something outside of dentistry that helped me focus on another part of life. And then I got out of dental school and I started practicing dentistry. And I was running faster than I had ever run before, and I was doing quite well. And people would say, why do you practice dentistry? And you could just run. And I was practicing part-time. It was very conducive to my training. And I said, you know what? It keeps me in touch with reality. And so I think I had a patient come in one time, and he got down in my chair, and he was so passionate about scuba diving. He told me all about his scuba diving. And I thought, that's how people feel when I talk about my running. So I think that the two have really played very, very well off each other, because I am very passionate about dentistry, and I really love what I do. And running, I still run to stay fit, and so it's still very much a passion. I think once you're a runner, you're kind of always a runner at heart. And then does it carry over into my parenting? Yes, very much so. I think running is a very therapeutic part of my parenting. When my oldest son was 4, he said, "Mama, why do you have to go on a run?" I said, "I'm going to go on a short run." And I said, "Do you want me to go on a short run, or do you want me to be grumpy all day long?" So that piece of it makes me more patient. It makes me more tolerant. It just makes me filled more with joy in what I can do with my children, too.
So I think we had someone in the back.
I don't know, Janis, if you remember me, I was actually before you. I was at the University of Minnesota, Anita Macias. Mm-hmm. I was on the track team from 74 to 78, and that was really the dinosaur time of women's sports.
Was
it was just at Title IX, the starting of the implementation of that. I can remember things. I remember running a road race, and we were asked to wear the T-shirts that were made up for the race, and they were all size larges. I mean, you know, the idea that women might be running this race, and so I had to tie and pin up my shirt so it wasn't dragging around my knees. And training shoes, I had to wear boys' training shoes, so they didn't make training shoes for women. So it was a lot different. And the women that I was on the team with, you know, you've talked about kind of this concept of, do you feel like you're part of a team? And we very much had this feeling of, well, we're kind of all in this together, a little bit of us against them, because, you know, sort of the women's place and the men's sports place and so forth. And that really changed a lot, even over a couple years. And Gary Wilson, once after I was off the team, asked me to come in once and talk to the women's team kind of about how it was, because he was trying to foster this feeling of, well, you know, understand kind of where the program has been and where you are now and, you know, why you have this. And it was sort of this big yawn, like, yeah, it's like 10 miles I had to walk in the rain and da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And so I'm wondering, there's such a range here in terms of when you were competing, if, you know, you have that kind of sense of it still, that, you know, we're women's sports and we're at where we at now, and it's still different, you know, from the men's sports. You know, you touched on that, how you can have careers with men's sports and so forth. And for women, it's still difficult. You can be on a professional team and still, you know, it's pretty difficult to earn a living. So kind of how do you see that now? Is there still that kind of same feeling? And, you know, do women sort of understand kind of where it's been and still this feeling, well, we got a ways to go?
Well, I think, you know, like I said before, it's pretty amazing that we can be able to do this for a living. And I do this full time. I run for Adidas full time. And on the side, I do some public speaking. I do some TV work. You know, I'm not a professional athlete where I have 3 homes and 5 cars. You know, Charlie and I have a nice little home, and we can drive cars, 2 cars, and, you know, but I love what I do. And would I love to be paid millions of dollars? Yes. But would I do it for free? Of course. So I think that it has come a long way. And gender-wise, I think track and field is starting to actually get pretty even. And I think even when I started in 2001, there was a difference. There, you know, a girl winning 5 NCAA championships might have made what a guy would make with 1. You know, 1 national championship, or maybe not even, but placing 3rd in the NCs. But, you know, now I don't think they look at that so much. I think, you know, even Kara Goucher, for instance, who is a name that we know of from Minnesota, and now she's from Oregon, and she's running the New York City Marathon. Well, it's pretty amazing that, you know, they can go now and get appearance fees and, you know, things like that, and just to come run their race. They get paid, no matter if they are 1st or 5th. I mean, they still get an appearance fee. And I don't know if they did that so much when you were running, but things are coming around. I remember Dick Beardsley saying he got an envelope of, I think he said, 10 $100 bills when he ran London. And now they pay a Dick Beardsley maybe $150,000 to go and run. So things have come a long ways. But, you know, it's an honor to do what we do. And I wouldn't change it for the world, so, yeah.
I think we got time for maybe 1 or 2 more. Yes?
I think can you hear me? Mm-hmm. I think you have sort of sold yourself a bit short, the 3 of you sitting there, because besides your own personal experiences, you've given a lot of other people who don't even know you the excitement of watching you win. And for those of us who worked in sport for years and years and years, to know that you've done well, you must put that into the equation of your understanding of what you've contributed. I saw Joan Benoit come into the stadium in 1984 when she won the marathon, the first woman to do it. And I sat, I didn't sit, I stood, and I cried buckets. Because this is the first time, and I've been to many Olympics, in which a woman had the whole Olympic stadium stand up and welcome her. So remember that, that there's the other side of this beside what you're giving and what you see is happening. You are giving a lot of other people, specifically women, the energy to continue on and to fight for what you have. Please don't forget that you owe something back to the sport itself, because we need you to keep this tradition going.
Maybe. I'm not sure if I can offer a better tribute than that. Maybe we can end there. I know Nicole has a few words to share.
To be up here on the stage with y'all. So thank you for such a wonderful evening. And to provide a fitting end note, in keeping with the Olympic tradition, talk about speed bumps. You know, sometimes you guys had so much energy in here, you blew up the last DVD in the back. So we're going to try it again. But to provide a fitting end, we have our own little mini closing ceremony. Now, we couldn't get fireworks approved, and they don't loan out the Olympic torch, but we got creative, and we put a little video together of a montage that not only honors our distinguished athletes on the stage, but other female Olympians that have a connection with the University of Minnesota. So rest assured, this closing ceremony lasts considerably less long than the ones that you see on TV. So we just have a minute 30 video. And this inspirational video was produced by Austin Calhoun, who's in the booth, holding her breath and going to play here in just a minute. And she did this in concert with the Intercollegiate Athletics. So I'm confident that you will enjoy it. So, master of ceremonies.